Thank you, Loa. I see many faces here that I know, many that I don't know yet, but I hope I'll have a chance to talk with more of you after this. When Loa asked me to give the keynote address for this Maya weekend and suggest the topic she'd like me to address, I took it as a deep honor for multiple reasons. Most directly, it's a privilege to be back to speak with the many friends of the Penn Museum and the many friends of the Maya weekend over these three decades. For me personally, it is, as Loa hinted, a coming home of sorts. And I have to say, it's lovely to be here. It's nice seeing old friends and meeting new ones, but it's lovely to be here. Perhaps most fundamentally, it's a privilege to talk about the theme of the evening, on recalling Maya ancestors with specific focus on Copan and Quirigua. As you're all well aware, Bob Scherer directed the early Copan Acropolis project for more than a cartoon, and before that directed Penn's Quirigua project in the 1970s. I hope you will accept my presentation tonight as offering thoughts about four revered kings of Copan and Quirigua, whom I'll get to in a moment, and as a tribute to the work through which Bob and his colleagues and students have supplied so much information about these kings and the cities of which they were the heads. I'd also like to note when Loa mentioned the textbook, Bob didn't survive to see it submitted to the press, but they were very helpful in understanding, and the cover of this revision is Copan images from Bob's work, from the Acropolis work. Was that music? No. So take a look. This is not shilling for buying it, but it's very attractive, and it's dedicated to him. Okay, I begin this talk with a brief review of the two cities and their politico-economic histories. Those are very familiar to many of you, but I want to highlight the context in which the four rulers I'm talking about existed. A few words on Maya mortuary practices follows that, and then from within the span of dynastic rule at the two sites, I'll review the lives and deaths and ancestral remembers of four kings, the two founders of the dynasties, and two kings whose altercation in AD 738, whose fates were entwined in either glorious or catastrophic ways, depending on who you asked at the time. Then I'll close with a few thoughts on some esteemed Mayanists' ancestors and how we recall and celebrate them. Okay, to Copan and Quirigua. K'inich Mo will come up later in the talk, but you can see that the two sites are down here in the Mesoamerican and Maya southeast, Copan here in what is now Honduras, Quirigua in the Motagua Valley of what is now Guatemala. Although this audience is surely quite well acquainted with Copan and Quirigua, I'd like to highlight some pertinent aspects of their economic circumstances and political history. The key point, as I said before, I shouldn't get off script, is to situate the four rulers, dynasty founders, and the two protagonists in AD 738 in the larger sweep of history. Each ruled polities with abundant human, agricultural, and mineral resources, and Copan dominated Quirigua affairs for much of the 4,000 years of dynastic rule. Those are the two takeaway points. First, both had abundant human resources and raw materials available to them. Each occupied agriculturally fertile river valley lands alongside, respectively, the Copan and Motagua rivers. The Copan River that runs through these pocket valleys and the Motagua River that runs toward the Caribbean Sea, to the Caribbean Sea. Copan, however, is located in the largest 25 square kilometers of several pocket highland valleys that you can see here along the Copan River. In contrast, Quirigua occupies the spot where the lower Motagua Valley opens into a 2,100 square kilometer expanse stretching northeast to the Caribbean. Commercial crops today of tobacco at Copan and bananas extending northeast from Quirigua attest to the continued agricultural value of these lands. I didn't include slides of the modern crops, but I had some Del Monte bananas the other day. Although maize was likely a principal crop in antiquity in both places, high-status cacao was likely also a part of local harvests in both valleys. So I included two slides of the physical location so that you could see the differences between the valley, but perhaps more dramatically in this slide prepared by Marcello Canuto and Ellen Bell, that shows you the location of Copan here along the valley. But you can see that it's in a highland kind of closed valley terrain, whereas Quirigua is located right here where the Motagua opens out into a huge valley, land of bananas now. Each political polity was also well situated to control, to control extraction and exchange of greatly valued minerals, jade upstream in the Motagua Valley from Quirigua, and high-quality obsidian, especially from the Ixtepeque sources. So here's, Copan, Quirigua, the approximate location of Ixtepeque for obsidian. Payson Sheets, who is in the audience, has done a lot of work with this, and Quirigua obsidian. And this green circle is the approximate location of the principal source of jade throughout Mesoamerica. It's been known for a long time approximately where it was, but it was only after one of the really devastating hurricanes in recent years that it exposed outcrops and stuff. So it's secure that it's there. Moreover, each city, Copan and Quirigua, was well positioned to monitor or even control movement of people and goods along rivers and overland corridors, linking in multiple directions with more distant people and mineral resources. Although each polity played a role in managing and moving these resources, Copan's political dominance from early times gave it the critical edge. These two advantageous locations supported well-established populations well before the advent of dynastic rule, who may or may not have been ethnically or linguistically Maya. By the 5th century, however, before the 5th century, however, events in politics and economics far afield were redefining the courses of history and politico-economic conditions for several kingdoms in the lowland Maya world, a key influence being distant Teotihuacan in central Mexico. The two parts of this image that I want to highlight are it doesn't perhaps show it as clearly. Forget the Pyramid of the Moon up here. But these smaller structures all have this talud tablero architectural profile, which has an upright tablet or tablero underlaying by a sloping surface, the talud. And this will be important in a moment. Whoops. What did I do? Oh, sorry. An unknown button. Okay, Teotihuacan. The other image I want you to see is this part of sculpture on the feathered serpent pyramid and sort of down here in the at Teotihuacan. And I want you to notice the goggle eyes on this mask. It's not a being so much as a mask. Strangers from Teotihuacan, strangers in quotes, from Teotihuacan entered the Maya lowlands late in the 4th century, in the 370s AD, and redirected dynastic rule at Tikal and Washaktun. Back to the map, Tikal and Washaktun, up here in the Petén of Guatemala. Back to the script. In the early 5th century, classic Maya-style dynastic rule with Teotihuacan connections was imposed on established society at Copan and Quirigua, where non-local men, perhaps both from Tikal, were installed to govern the local populace. At Copan, a man named Yax K'uk Mo, whom you'll see more of in a moment, wrested authority from existing local powers, partly likely by military measures, and he has the scars to show it in his bones. And having been invested by distant powers with insignia and titles of his office in September of 426, arrived formally at Copan as Copan King, K'inich Yax K'uk Mo, radiant first Quetzal Macaw, some 5 months later, or February of 427. Relations with the ousted leaders seem to have, relations with the ousted leaders at Copan, darn, I keep losing. Relations with the ousted leaders seem to have involved a fair amount of diplomacy with the apparent marriage of K'inich Yax K'uk Mo, whom you see here, and a local woman from a leading family, and subsequent preservation for at least some of the buildings of his predecessors at the Copan Civic Corps as the new king built his capital slightly to the southeast. And Loa has written extensively about this, so I refer you to her work. In ensuing centuries, subsequent Copan kings solidified dynastic rule and fortunes were generally good for Copan. These are just portraits. Notice the goggle-eyed representation. This will keep coming up, but a partial allusion to Teotihuacan. At Quirigua, fewer details are known. We don't have a portrait of the founder that I know of. What?
He's on Facebook.
Yes, that's good. That's good. When I was trying to show a picture of a colleague for my intro class at UCR, and he didn't have a picture on the web, I just picked one of these and then put a smiley face in it. I avoided the smiley face for this guy. Cute, though. Okay, at Quirigua, fewer details are known. Its imposed Maya king, nicknamed Toc Casper, was invested with insignia of his new office on September 8, 426, under supervision of Copan's dynastic founder only 3 days after the latter was so invested. For at least another 300 years, the hierarchical relation between Copan and Quirigua established at that time persisted such that, among other things, resources directly available to Quirigua were most likely managed from Copan. Quirigua was perhaps also a central communication and exchange link between Copan and other Tikal-friendly polities from the lower Motagua Valley to the Belize Valley far to the north. As we'll see in a moment, such long-distance alliances figure in later events, reflecting ongoing political competition between Tikal in what is now Guatemala and Calakmul in what is now Campeche, Mexico. At 5th and 6th centuries, Copan and Quirigua, conditions were primarily prosperous, but touched by conflict as well, intermittent conflict. In fact, extensive destruction of stone monuments at Copan between AD 554 and 564 approximately suggests some major disruptions, perhaps related to the premature death of Copan ruler IX after only 2 years' reign, or even to faraway Calakmul's defeat of Copan's longtime ally, my cat's name is Ally, ally, Tikal. The same 6th century span lacks monuments and texts at Quirigua as well, but includes defacement of at least two earlier portrait stelae, perhaps from military intervention, military conflict. Then, in the 7th century, disaster struck Quirigua in the form of major flooding that damaged, destroyed, or washed away an immeasurably large part of the capital, including civic buildings, maybe even a ball court associated with one or more of its first four rulers. Immediately gone were both the bountiful maize and cacao harvests, and at a time when John Wingard has proposed that Copan had begun to require maize tribute from valley pockets upstream from to its northeast, I believe that Copan's ruler 12, also known as Smoke Emish, may have begun to pressure some such tribute from vassal Quirigua. In AD 650, I have it 52 at one place, 53 at another, Quirigua Altar L records Smoke Emish as overseeing Quirigua's celebration of a Katun period ending. Epigrapher Matt Looper sees this monument as reaffirming, quote, participation of Quirigua in Copan's political sphere, unquote. Perhaps such reaffirmation on an important period ending date coincided with aid to Quirigua in its recovery from the flood, as well as also the reaffirmation of Quirigua's tribute requirements to address Copan's increasing need for imported food. And so Quirigua's indebtedness to Copan grew. In AD 724-25, however, new and ambitious Quirigua king acceded to rule. Tiliw Chan Yo'at. If you want to remember that name, it's okay. I also call him Tiliw for short, and I will refer to him as the rebel king as well, to make it hopefully easier. 12 years later, having inherited the growing tribute load and perhaps seeing a way to throw off Copan's yoke, Tiliw accepted support from far-off Calakmul, the perennial enemy of Tikal and its allies. On one of the most famous dates in Lowland Maya history, one of the earliest deciphered political dates, in AD 738, the date is 915-6-14-6 in the Maya calendar. I learned that early. I'm not an epigrapher, but I learned that one early. On one of the most famous dates in Lowland Maya history, Tiliw Chan Yo'at successfully captured and 6 days later beheaded his Copan counterpart, its 13th king, Waxaklahun-Ub'ah-K'awil. This is from Simon Martin and Nikolai Gruba's book, and in fact highlights the axe event there. But you can see this is the end of the date for recording, and then the axe event, which is translated, as I understand it, as decapitate or chop. And you can see somebody's getting hit in the head. But decapitate, and then the name spelled out, Waxaklahun-Ub'ah-K'awil. We'll come back to that in a little while. But that's as much as you need to remember Waxaklahun-Ub'ah-K'awil as the name. The result was an end to Copan's unchallenged sovereignty over political and economic relations of the region, including assertion of whole new polities on both the Motagua Valley side and over the mountains into what is now Honduras. Seizing power in the wake of this new political vacuum. In the aftermath, Tiliw, the rebel king, built the Quirigua Civic Center, especially its expansive public areas, studded with monuments to himself. The thatch roofs are, of course, modern. He didn't put thatch roofs on the monument. Earlier, his victim, Copan's ruler 13, I wanted to fast forward to this, had peopled Copan's main plaza with self-portraits of himself. And Bill Fash and David Stewart said long ago that they felt that Coctilio's, the Quirigua ruler's mimicry attempt was almost a parody. You can see here in the maps, although they're not equivalent in the format, the main plaza of the principal group at Copan. And all these stelae, most of them, not all of them, but most of them pertain to the 13th ruler. And here at Quirigua, the monuments are just marked by M's and little dots, but they are mostly, not all, mostly pertain to Tiliw, the rebel king. Instead of erecting, the effect on Copan after the decapitation, the effect was profound. Its next, 14th ruler, lost significant economic resources as well as political and military face. Instead of erecting a portrait stela of himself, he built a council house, or popol na, where he consulted with the heads of districts under his newly weakened authority. This is Barbara Fash's wonderful rendering of the popol na, the council house. With people gathering, with the identification of different districts in the upper register of the roof, where he consulted. Importantly, this building was erected next to the palace of his beheaded predecessor atop the Copan Acropolis. You can just barely see. Oops, sorry. You can just barely see the edge of that in here. Subsequent decades showed gradually renewed prosperity in both Quirigua and Copan, and saw equally gradual restoration of diplomatic relations between the two, including the old dominance of Copan. The end of the Copan dynasty is recognized in AD 822 with the incomplete altar U and the king that we don't know much of anything about, Ukitok. The last inscription at Quirigua was earlier, in AD 810, recording its Copan overlord overseeing a ritual at Quirigua. Quirigua dynastic rule might have continued somewhat without record, occupation as much as four decades longer, but no more. The key point of this section has been to situate the four rulers, two dynasty founders and the two protagonists of the AD 738 event, in the larger sweep of history, ups and downs and different power relations. Each ruled polities with abundant human, agricultural, and mineral resources, and Copan dominated Quirigua affairs for much of the 400 years of dynastic rule. How were they treated then, at and after their deaths? What acts of remembrance are evident for each? Okay. Sorry, it's that one I wanted to go to. These are portraits of the four kings involved. You saw K'inich Yax K'uk Mo at the upper left before, and the Facebook Tuk Casper next to him. And in the lower register are Waxaklahun-Ub'ah-K'awil, the 13th king of Copan, and Tiliw Chan Yo'at, the rebel king of Quirigua. What acts of remembrance are evident for each? First, let me recount some pertinent aspects of ancient Maya mortuary practices. Many royal tombs, as you know, have been documented in the last half century, beginning with the famous tomb of Pakal the Great in Palenque in the 1950s. Such discoveries tell us much about the interred individuals, and in tandem with hieroglyphic, iconographic, and archaeological evidence, round out details of political history. For both royal and non-royal decedents, studies of Maya mortuary practices and ancestor veneration have analyzed the customs by which the living shepherded revered dead through transitions from death to the afterworld. Patricia McEnany, who I don't know if she's here yet, will be here tomorrow speaking, she's here. Patricia, hi. Hi, there she is. As I understand, has just released a revised edition of Living with the Ancestors. Yes? No? Okay, forthcoming. The original version has been a classic reference work, and I look forward to seeing the new edition. Drawing from mutually differing but complementary evidence, James Fitzsimmons and Pamela Geller have recently detailed the intricate processes that most plausibly attended ancient Maya death, mourning, departure of multiple souls, and in all, the social transformation of both the dead and the living. Notably, these diverse processes and stages potentially extended from almost indefinitely in time. Fitzsimmons' records attest that these spans could last up to 24 years. We'll see if that record holds. Material evidence for which includes re-entry of burial chambers and frequent removal of select skeletal evidence. Increasingly, Mayanist scholars recognize as well that intact bodies were only one option for interment, and in fact, their presence was not an absolute requirement to constitute a burial. The problematic deposits at Tikal are part evidence of this, that, you know, when is a burial, and when is a cache. Especially for members of the royalty, thigh bones, femurs, fingers, and especially skulls or faces could be kept as heirlooms, worn in the attire of descendants, displayed and handled during rites of ancestor veneration or earth offerings, or displayed as trophies. If and when the body or its individual elements were unavailable for interment, the deceased could still be acknowledged, and if the lack of a corpse altogether were due to capture or other violence, the crypt's material recognition as a place for remembrance could assume added importance. Such an instance of a cenotaph with no body in it I've inferred for a young noble at Quirigua who was commemorated in a well-prepared stone chamber when Ed Shortman took off the cover of the tomb. He expected to find a skeleton. And I have this wonder, I didn't include it, I have this wonderful slide of Ed sitting there looking at three vessels and saying, anyway, three pottery vessels, but devoid of human remains. So let us now turn to the documented mortuary practices and acts of remembrance, including most of those just described, for those four kings of Copan and Quirigua. Thanks to the last four decades of research at the two sites, we are learning much about the men and occasionally women of each polity's royal dynasty. As stated at the outset, I focus today on just four of the dynastic kings, the founders of each dynasty in the 5th century AD and the pair of royal protagonists in Quirigua's 8th century overthrow of Copan's longstanding control. How were these individuals treated at and after their deaths? What acts of remembrance are evident for each? First, the founders. Here we are again. The life and death of dynasty founder K'inich Yax K'uk Mo had profound impact on Copan's political, ritual, sculptural, and architectural history. Although we don't know precisely when he died, it was surely sometime between AD 435 and 437. I think you guys said 437? Okay. A decade after he became king of Copan, he was laid carefully out on his back for burial on a large elevated stone slab set in a vaulted chamber, together with a mortuary offering assemblage of 21 pottery vessels, four of them with pottery lids, and other high status objects of carved jade, shell, and bone. The chamber itself was intruded more than 2 meters into the building known as Hunal. Up here, here's the intrusion, there's the slab, that's this slab. Inside, building known as Hunal, constructed as the founder's principal residence during his lifetime. Its Tiliw tablero facade profile is strongly reminiscent of buildings in central Mexico that I tried to point out before. Here's the Tiliw and the tablero, the sloping part right beneath it. You'll see this again, I think, a little clearer. And the scene painted on a vessel placed outside the later tomb of his probable wife is thought to depict the Hunal building, with the face of K'inich Yax K'uk Mo in its doorway. The goggle-eyed visage is the same as later depictions of the man, notably a censer cover from 7th century royal tomb, you'll see again, and the famous dynastic portrait gallery of 8th century altar Q, Copan altar Q. You can see here, this is a rendering of the, it got kind of cut off, but here's the tablero and the Tiliw beneath. Here's the tablero and the, no, too many buttons. And here's the tablero and the Tiliw on Hunal. Here's the depiction, the tablero and the Tiliw, this particular profile. And there's Yax K'uk Mo with his goggle eyes in the doorway of this building. Content of the Hunal tomb bore multiple references to a far-flung Teotihuacan-linked network, with Hunal tomb finds resembling others from Tikal, Kaminalhuyu in the Guatemalan highlands, and Teotihuacan itself. Neutron activation analyses of tomb pottery identifies Tikal as the actual source of 2 vessels, central Mexico the source of 5, the Copan Valley 11, and the Quirigua vicinity 2 more. Royal allusions to Teotihuacan in central Mexico would recur with varying intensity at Copan for nearly 400 years to the dynasty's end. Early on, however, for example, Yenal, the platform, here's this based on one of Loa's wonderful maps. I think it's adapted. You can see the location, You can see the location of the Hunal structure here in profile, and the location of the Yenal structure, which sealed the founder's tomb. And on the facade of which you see these portraits of the sun god, Yenal. The platform constructed atop Hunal and sealing the founder's tomb bore the Mexican year sign and torches in its sculpted facade in the headdress up here. In the headdress of the sun god, which Carl Tauba describes as, quote, surely the apotheosized K'inich Yax K'uk Mo. Its architectural style, however, was more like the apron molding of the Maya lowlands instead of the Mexican Tiliw tablero profile, attesting to dynastic Copan's varied heritage. Here you can just make out Hunal and the Hunal building and Yenal and the founder's tomb. And here's the Margarita platform that we'll talk about next. And like Yenal, it has this kind of apron molding profile, not the Tiliw tablero stuff, more Maya in emphasis. In death, then, Copan's founder was treated with great reverence, and there is clear material evidence that his tomb remained accessible and tomb contents movable, at least until his body decomposed, when the red of cinnabar was spread on his bones. Acts of reverent remembrance continued with the reign of his son, ruler II, and then through the end of the Copan royal dynasty in AD 822. In Loa Traxler's words, ruler II probably represented the foreign ancestry of his father as well as the local prestige of his mother, and his works could represent a resolution to the conflict between the foreign usurper and the local elite. Indeed, as we'll see in a second, his mother's tomb is in many ways more elaborate than his father's, so more homage perhaps to the local family. Ultimately, the most dramatic aspect of these acts of remembrance, of these acts of remembrance is that the founder's tomb, Hunal, became the spot above which subsequent ancestor shrines were erected, repeatedly reestablishing the axis mundi, the center of the universe, the center of the world center specifically here of Copan, the city, and Copan, the polity. I'll get to that in a second. Ellen Bell has detailed the sequence of Acropolis tombs, burials, and offerings of the early classic period until about 600 on this spot, which she identifies with the process of materializing and extending the dynasty, and anchored especially by Hunal, its tomb, and the Margarita structure and tomb of his presumed wife. Indeed, as hinted a moment ago, Bell and her colleagues consider the Margarita platform and tomb as part of a grand remodeling of the dynastic shrine begun by their son, ruler II. Constructed atop Hunal and Yenal platforms, the Margarita platform facade bears an emblematic depiction of the founder's name, K'inich Yax K'uk Mo, which you can see here. I'm sure you've seen it before in talks at the Penn Museum. Here is a sort of scrunched up version of the facade that shows written in a depicted version of his name, K'inich in the two sun god faces in the birds' mouths, Yash in these curls above the birds, and then K'uk, Quetzal, and Mo, the scarlet macaw. Like the founder's tomb, that of his wife in Margarita remained accessible at least until her bones were exposed and covered with cinnabar. And that vessel that I described before, frequently called the Dazzler, with the depiction of depiction of Yax K'uk Mo in the doorway of the Hunal building, was placed in the outer chamber of the Margarita tomb during one of the re-entries or visitations of the mother's tomb, the wife's tomb. A century later, the deliberately and magnificently preserved Rosalila temple, discovered, documented, and interpreted by Ricardo Agosia Fasquel, sitting right there. See, I told you it was here. Was Copan's imposing ancestor shrine of the late 6th century, situated on the same axis mundi as the founder's tomb. As you can see here, directly above Hunal, Margarita, etc. As Simon Martin and Nikolai Gruber remark, Rosalila's interior was blackened by smoke and incense, rituals appropriate to its role at the heart of ancestral veneration, and vents in its facade, here you see in the reconstruction, vents here, were designed so that billowing clouds of incense smoke and other smoke would interact with the sculpture in an animated tableau. This is a magnificent building, now preserved in the Copan Museum at Copan. The final version of Copan's royal ancestor shrine sequence was structure 10L16, or structure 16 for short, dedicated in AD 776, with its multiple sculptural allusions to K'inich Yax K'uk Mo and to the Mexican motifs prominently featured in the founder's imagery. At the base of this final tower, I want you to note the height of that. We'll come back to that in a bit. At the base of this final temple stair, Altar Q recounts the dynastic foundation events on this top surface with portraits of all 16 Copan kings in order on its four sides. Here, beginning with the founder, K'inich Yax K'uk Mo, then ruler 2, and then going around ruler 3, 4, 5, coming up to ruler 15, and then ruler 16. Again, we'll come back to the imagery there. As an offering placed beneath Altar Q's base, whoops, great National Geographic image. An offering placed beneath Altar Q's base included 15 jaguar skeletons, jaguars being avatars for Maya kings. These 15 skeletons were thought to represent the royal predecessors of the king who commissioned structure 16 and the altar at its base. The altar's west face emphatically proclaims the momentous importance of the dynasty founder. In the passage of the scepter of royal authority here, from the founder K'inich Yax K'uk Mo to ruler 16, Yashpasa Chan Yo'at, ruler 16, facing each other across glyphs for the date of the first king's accession. In sum, the acts of remembrance for Copan's founder were varied in nature, both public and private, and quite persistent across time. His tomb remained accessible for some years after his death, as we noted earlier, and his name was invoked repeatedly in architectural and other sculpture. From the reign of his son to the dynasty's end, he was remembered consistently with great honor. At Quirigua, the story is parallel but different in significant ways. We have considerably less information about its dynastic founder, Tok Caspar. Based on retrospective accounts of his accession events in AD 426, he was an outsider to the area, but unlike analyses at Copan, we lack bone and tooth chemistry analyses to specify this founder's original home. Scherer and Traxler suggest he may have accompanied Yax K'uk Mo from Tikal. In any event, he died before AD 455, by which date his successor had assumed the throne. Some time ago, Bob Scherer identified this founder's probable burial site in a cist grave lined by stone slabs beneath one of the earliest buildings of the Quirigua Acropolis, the red-painted adobe structure 1B63. This is a slide kindly forwarded to me by Chris Jones from his work and Dave McCormick, and I want to acknowledge those. I'm sorry that words seem to have spilled off. This is the initial ancestral shrine with a low platform next to it. This founder too, that is Quirigua's, was laid on his back on the slab flooring of the grave. Scherer based his linking of this burial with that of the Copan founder on its occurrence at an appropriate and datable stratigraphic level within the Quirigua Acropolis, on its position on the east side of the Acropolis compound, akin to royal burial placement elsewhere in the Maya lowlands, and similarity to K'inich Yax K'uk Mo in the pattern of their notched and jade inlaid teeth. This is a photograph of the jaw from that Quirigua burial in the lab. This is a black and white photograph on which I put little green dots where the jade was in Yax K'uk Mo's teeth. Other than these similarities, however, the Quirigua founder's burial is strikingly different from that of his Copan counterpart. Plausibly a reflection of Quirigua's status as subordinate to Copan from the onset of dynastic time. Quirigua dynastic founder Tok Caspar was buried with a much simpler grave preparation and strikingly fewer and less elaborate grave offerings, whereas the Copan founder's tomb was intruded with great effort 2 meters into the heart of his principal residence. Quirigua's structure 1B63 was built to cover the Quirigua founder's grave, and we have no idea where his principal residence was. The stone slab line chamber for Tok Caspar contrasts with the stone vaulted founder's tomb at Copan, and contrasting the rich assemblage of grave offerings at Copan, the offerings at Quirigua were a set of 3 simple bowls that you can see here, and the jade bead placed in his mouth, a frequent Maya custom. An offering of two red, flaring wall, flat-bottomed vessels were encountered in the fill above the burial pit. And although surmounting construction by unstable cobble fill is so different from Copan, may blur things, there is no stratigraphic evidence, and Chris, you can correct me if I'm off on this, there's no stratigraphic evidence of re-entry to place those vessels. Chris is nodding. Thank you. The Quirigua founder's bones were certainly not painted red. From that point on, the principal contrasts in acts of remembrance for the two founders are not the practices per se, but instead the scale and elaboration of their expression. Repeated renovation of the Copan Acropolis Axis Mundi yielded a towering architectural monument, with culminating construction of Structure 6 being the tallest and most visible building of the Acropolis, in view far beyond the royal precinct across the valley. It's a huge construction. At Quirigua, however, although founder Tok Casper was acknowledged with periodic renovation of the ancestor shrine overlying his grave, that eastern structure remained small in expanse, height, and decoration, as you'll see in subsequent slides. As residential and ceremonial architecture rose around the other sides of the Quirigua Acropolis, these ancestral shrine buildings, those new buildings collectively dwarfed the founder's ancestral shrine, which became invisible, unlike Structure 16 at Copan, became invisible to anyone not close within the royal compound. It even appears, I'll get to that in a second. It even appears that no new enhancement of the founder's shrine took place in the 7th century, the time of flood recovery, when Copan's ruler 12 arguably stepped in to help. Instead, Acropolis construction efforts went most prominently into creating a ball court. Here's the ancestor shrine. Here's a ball court, two structures to the north, a string of buildings to the south. Instead of Acropolis constructions, Quirigua Acropolis constructions went most prominently into creating a ball court, rather like that at Copan, as you see here. As Chris Jones has suggested, Quirigua Altar L, on which Copan's ruler 12 is named, may even have been a marker for the alley of that ball court. In short, reaffirming the power differentials between Copan and Quirigua was, at that point, was apparently more important to the Quirigua ruler than celebrating Quirigua's founding ancestors. So the emphasis shifts. Moving to the other pair of kings in these cities, the adversaries of AD 738 are relatively well known from inscriptions and their material legacy. I've suggested that a principal impetus for their clash lay in growing tribute demands on Quirigua and in the opportunistic ambition of its most famous king, K'inich Yax K'uk Mo, Yo'at, the rebel king. His overlord at Copan, the 13th ruler, our good friend Waxaklahun-Ub'ah-K'awil, was certainly ambitious too, known more for his grand architectural and sculptural legacy than for his military triumphalism. In Quirigua's K'inich Yax K'uk Mo seems to have leapt, however, at an opportunity for alliance with and support from distant Calakmul, longstanding enemy of Tikal and its alliance network. As noted earlier, in the spring of 738, he captured the Copan king and 6 days later beheaded him in an act interpreted hieroglyphically and unceremoniously as an axe event. The event essentially reversed hierarchical relations between the two cities during Coctilio's reign. Quirigua's rebel king then died six decades later in AD 785, with regional politics and economy still in disarray. He caused a real mess, and it just kept going on. So how were these two eighth-century kings treated at and after their deaths? What acts of remembrance are evidence for each of them? The mortuary practice in these cases are quite unlike following the founders' deaths. For Copan's ruler 13, Waxaklahun-Ub'ah-K'awil, no tomb has been encountered, despite the impressive set of tombs that have been documented at Copan. His remains might lie undetected in areas untouched by excavation, or it may be that his death at Quirigua deprived his heirs and subjects of his formal interment. Initially, at least, Waxaklahun-Ub'ah-K'awil was remembered materially in other ways, a prominent expression occurring in the final renovation of Copan's hieroglyphic stairway, and its late 8th century record of dynastic history by ruler 15. About ruler 13 and the stairway, Bill Fash writes, quote, "The date of ruler 13's death is cited in the final stairway, ennobling it by saying that he perished with his flint and with his shield, that is, on the field of battle, a little bit more respectful than the axe event described at Quirigua." So it may well be that a good deal of the martial iconography on the final, this is still Bill Fash talking, on the final version of this singular stairway monument does in fact, as we had originally thought, represent an attempt to compensate for the loss of ruler 13 to a former vassal from Quirigua. End quote. Half a century after ruler 13's death, the 16th Copan king, the final effective Copan king, acknowledged his revered, if unfortunate, predecessor, his dynastic ancestor, to a degree that some have characterized as near obsession. I think this is an article by David Stewart in 1992 on texts. Among other acts of remembrance, the later sovereign likely commissioned the imposing architectural compound where beheaded ruler 13 was celebrated in ritual acts and permanent architectonic display of a text bearing his name, Waxaklahun-Ub'ah-K'awil, his royal title, and a hieroglyphic date most plausibly marking an anniversary of his death. This is the same text you saw before with the axe event. The two stones at the lower right are two of a series we found fallen from a building at Copan, a kilometer straight north from the principal group. And you can see here that this name, you all know Maya numbers? 18. Okay, 18 rabbit is a nickname often. 18, Waxaklahun-Ub'ah-K'awil. This is alternatively identified as a rodent, as a dog, as a rabbit. I prefer rabbit. But anyway, some kind of small mammal. You can see here the 18, the rodent face, the superfix above the rodent face, and then the next one is the K'awil, the god with the smoke ensuing from his forehead. Here's the smoke ensuing from his forehead. That is the god of royalty. Elsewhere, Chris Kitchen, who is here in the audience, Pamela Geller and I have proposed that this architectural compound, known prosaically as Copan's Group 8L10 and 8L12, or the Copan North Group, ultimately sheltered fragments of Ruler 13's skull, plausibly returned to his home by later repacified lords of Quirigua, some 62 years after the axe event of 738. The skull fragments in question, were encountered within a bowl that was ostensibly a grave offering. Here's the bowl. A grave offering to two individuals, a man and a woman, interred in tomb burial in the northern half of the North Group. That this was ostensibly a grave offering for them. But the two intact skeletons in the tomb, a man and a woman, were, in my view, not the ones honored in this funerary chamber. Rather, I believe that the skull fragments were much more weathered. You can't see them here, but much more weathered than these beautifully intact skeletons of the man and woman. I believe that the skull fragments, which were much more weathered, were components in a complex act of remembrance for Ruler 13 that was expressed across the entire compound, its buildings, its architectonic sculpture, like the name of Waxaklahun-Ub'ah-K'awil of Ruler 13, this interment, and even an offering placed at the entry to the compound that I believe commemorated the circumstances of his death by decapitation in 738. I didn't include an image of that. It's a simple sphere cut in half. And I think that was a reference to decapitation. That's another story. The skull, that most potent of bodily elements, came to stand for the whole man, to be commemorated at last by the act of interment and continued mortuary ritual at the spot. And probably not coincidentally, the tomb of his loyal successor, Ruler 16, the last effective king, is located in the Acropolis due south. Julie Miller and I were kind of had an aha moment when we looked at the wonderful maps of Copan produced out of Proyecto Arqueológico Copan, and it's absolutely due north of Ruler 16's tomb. Anyway, the final case of kings here and their deaths is Quirigua's rebellious k'ak Tiliw Chan Yo'at. It differs yet again, at least in part. Before his death in AD 785, after 62 years on the throne, this king rewrote the history materialized in the civic center of his polity through architecture and sculpted monuments, as you've seen before. Acknowledging predecessors, but emphatically stressing in text the new regime, its association with creation events, and its new superiority to Copan, including those Acts event passages. Its central message for visitors to the Civic Center became tightly bound up with this single, aggressively assertive king. As hinted earlier, it was left to Quirigua successors, known as Sky Shul and Jade Sky, to manage his legacy and ultimately to repair relations with Copan. The rebel king's immediate successor, Sky Shul, sealed the Quirigua dynastic founder's ancestral shrine with a long, low platform on which he then commissioned a newer, on which he commissioned a newer, larger version of that shrine. He celebrated the founder in new construction and texts on new sculpted monuments. The same king then proceeded to perform in rituals honoring both rebel king k'ak Tiliw and his vanquished lord, Copan, ruler 13, at each of their capitals. In short, he sought to promote better relations with Copan without castigating his antecedent king. The next successor, however, and final Quirigua ruler, had a distinctly different diplomatic strategy, seeking favor from Copan's king while pushing Quirigua's rebel king and his action out of the picture as much as possible. There is some irony in the fact that the Copan king in question was ruler 16, that staunch devotee of his predecessor, ruler 13, who had been beheaded at Quirigua. So still trying to win him back. How did these strategies shape remembers of the rebel king k'ak Tiliw within his capital? There are no direct indications of where or how he was buried after his death in 785. Indeed, no royal burials except that of the founder have been encountered at Quirigua, but I have an idea about where this king might have been interred. Isn't this exhilarating? Fancy. Martin and Gruba give some tantalizing clues when they say, on the quarter Khatun ending in AD 795, this rebel king's immediately successor scattered droplets at the 13 Kawak House, the burial site and memorial shrine of his predecessor, k'ak Tiliw Chan Yo'at. This event came 10 years after k'ak Tiliw's death, and its location is not at all clear from the inscriptions. I believe that 13 Kawak House, or one of its versions, may have been part of Group 7, what we call Group 7A1, what Morley called Group B. By 1975, a very unimposing plowed-over plaza group a kilometer and a half west of the modern park. If you go there today, don't try to find it. It looks worse than that. This is Group B, Group 7A1, and this is the tallest structure. All plowed over. So this is Ed Shortman. He's about 6 feet tall. Whoops, no, no. So I think the key to understanding Group 7A1 and perhaps this burial place for k'ak Tiliw is understanding Stela S, or Monument 19, the one that you see here with Ed as scale and here as it was set when we found it. Stela S was dedicated in 746 AD, according to its inscription, and was the earliest of k'ak Tiliw's, the rebel king's portrait stela, dedicated 6 years after the successful revolt. Archaeological evidence from both the Quirigua Great Plaza and Group 7A1 suggests that Stela S had been moved and re-erected in a new location. 1977 excavations in the Great Plaza encountered the remains of a masonry cap for a stela foundation. It's the red star there, but lacking a stela. Its location would mark the third corner of a triangle, together with those two blue circles, the third corner of a triangle with the other two earliest of the Quirigua rebel king's portrait monuments following the Copan break, a logical place for stela S. In group 7A1, on the other hand, the foundations that archaeologists encountered for Stele S are unlike those of the two other early monuments, Stele H and J, and more similar to the cribbing support beneath Stele I, one of the final Quirigua kings, that is, Jade Sky, portrait monuments dedicated in AD 800. So in short, a monument dedicated in 746, where found by archaeologists had been erected with an AD 800 foundation, 54 years out of sync. If the inferred chronology here is roughly correct, resetting followed the rebel king's death by perhaps fewer than 20 years. Because Stele S was reset in the center of a small, publicly accessible plaza, it seems a place where, these are the foundations, I'm sorry, I missed that. This is the 800 style cribbing foundation. The ones for the earlier monuments were much simpler. If the inferred chronology here is correct, resetting followed the rebel king's death by perhaps fewer than 20 years. Because Stele S was reset in the center of a small, publicly accessible plaza, it seems a place where continued royal veneration could have taken place, with its somewhat removed location, a diplomatic step by royal peacemaker Jade Sky, Quirigua's final king, to allow commemoration of the infamous rebel king. In Bob Scherer's felicitous phrase, Stele S was the rebel king's Stele of independence. Local, it was a personal communication, so unfortunately it's not in print. In Bob's local respects to the king and his earliest post-revolt monument could still be paid, but in a more isolated location for its expression, far away from the Quirigua main center and the likely docking place where people would have entered the site in antiquity, and thereby perhaps less offensive to visiting dignitaries from Copan. In that regard, group 7A1 might parallel the previously mentioned memorial group at Copan in its north group as a place to commemorate a venerable and sometimes controversial king, in the Copan case honoring the very same king who had fallen victim to the Quirigua revolt. However, while the Copan king who sponsored this memorial recognition of his assassinated predecessor also honored that sovereign in multiple other ways, Quirigua's final king at about the same time distanced himself from his own disruptive forerunner. Jade Sky's distancing was material and literal in the relocation of Stele S, in contrast to more muted distancing in texts where Matt Looper says the uprising is dismissed at, quote, as a thing of the past, engineered by a now defunct foreign power. So there. Neither Sylvanus Morley's excavations in the 1920s nor our own in 1977 encountered any evidence of a tomb in Group 7A1, although probes may have stopped short of an appropriate location, and the entire compound had been severely eroded and damaged by the time of our 1977 inquiry. I shudder to think what it looks like now. It's been reburied by a banana plantation. Never mind, don't get me into this. Nevertheless, I offer the possibility that Group 7A1 could well have been the final resting place of K'uk Tiliw, a meaningful placement for which relocation of the independent Stele S perhaps provided closing accentuation. In this case, mortuary practices would have been spread, perhaps intermittently, over more than 15 years. The place of inferred final interment is certainly situated appropriately at the western edge of the legendary king's capital, in the direction whose meaning is death. The foregoing presentation has discussed mortuary practices and ancestor veneration for four classic Maya kings, the dynasty founders at Copan and Quirigua, and the 8th century protagonists or antagonists in a reversal of centuries-old relations between the same two polities. What I've sought to show is that the customs scholars have documented for classic Maya death and commemoration were prominent in the case of those four rulers. For each, however, the specifics of remembrance actions and the intensity of their expression varied considerably. That is, both dynasty founders were honored at their death and celebrated for generations after through creation of later ancestor shrines overlying their places of interment. Here you see, again, the image of structure 16, the culminating ancestral shrine at Copan, and here's the final version of the Quirigua Acropolis with the final version of the ancestral shrine here. Very small in comparison with the architecture, and very small for sure in comparison with that at Copan. Each was buried soon after death in the polity capital in its emerging royal center. The political hierarchy in Copan-Quirigua relations, however, from the time of the 5th century establishment of the two dynasties, seems evident in the kinds of interments, relative abundance of grave offerings, and scale of subsequent ancestor shrine elaboration. In contrast, for the two 8th century kings, our knowledge is equivalent in that we can't say definitely where or how these rulers were buried. Their posthumous commemoration is clear in texts post-dating their deaths and to some extent in construction acts by their successors. At Copan, ruler 13 was lamented from the time of his beheading, his loss prompting profound changes in Copan governance thereafter, sharing royal authority with local leaders in the council house and softening the portrayal of revered ruler 13's death as lost nobly in battle rather than the stark allusion to beheading at Quirigua. If the skull fragments I discussed are his, his mortuary transition conceivably lasted up to 62 years until final interment north of the Copan Civic Center, far longer than the 24-year maximum span Fitzsimmons reports. At Quirigua, on the other hand, its rebel king's death elicited serially different responses from his two final royal successors. Immediately after his death, the rebel king Cactilia was still honored, although actions of the new Quirigua king sought quickly to assuage Copan's wrath. And Quirigua's final king sought to distance himself as far as possible from his rebellious predecessor. In inscriptions and construction acts, and perhaps that king's mortal remains, placement of that king's mortal remains some 15 to 20 years after his death. In preparing this talk, I thought constantly about the contributions of Maya scholars, archaeologists, and otherwise, upon whose work this presentation depends. We note the loss of too many of these scholars, remembering and celebrating them in our collective ongoing research, as well as our fond and admiring recollections. It seems to me fitting to recall just a few of them today at the outset of this weekend devoted to recalling the ancestors, Maya traditions across time. Those I want to acknowledge today are Gordon R. Willey, William R. Coe, and Robert J. Shearer. Gordon Willey was long the dean of Mesoamerican and especially Maya archaeology. You see here Gordon and his wife Catherine visiting Quirigua, Bob showing him stuff of the excavation at Structure 183, and here is a young Richard Leventhal. I threatened him with a talk. Don't shake your head, Richard. The innovator of settlement pattern research, now standard in projects all over the world, Willey was in fact concerned with all aspects of ancient society, Maya and otherwise. Together with Bill Coe and Bob Shearer, both of whom were then working at Quirigua, Willey laid out a game plan in 1975 for long-term research at Copan, from which his own immediate and other subsequent Copan research has drawn, I think we would all agree, not only explicitly, but obviously with great productivity. Bill Coe was long a leading figure in Maya archaeology here at Penn, and as a contributor to the Copan research plan I just cited. Associated most readily with the Penn-Tikal research, Bill was instrumental in launching the Penn project at Quirigua in 1975. As a member of the latter project, I can attest to his strongest attachment to his most enduring project. At Quirigua, he repeatedly completed record forms designating the research location as Tikal. Earlier on, he had introduced Bob Shearer to Chalchuapa, El Salvador. That place became the focus of Bob's dissertation and the beginning of his archaeological research in the Maya Southeast. These are pictures of Bill at various stages at Tikal, at Quirigua, learning how to ride a motorcycle, not very well. It's Bob's motorcycle. And here, just earlier than that, in the Salima Valley of Guatemala. The entire slide of the right image has Bill looking that way, David Sidat marching in away into the distance, and Bob Shearer marching this way into the distance. And of course we remember Bob Shearer, who has had such impact on Maya and Mesoamerican studies and in Penn's involvement in Maya archaeology for more than four decades. He was an expert research designer, creative research implementer, master communicator, and generous, congenial collaborator. His former students also remember him as well, as a serious advisor with at the same time an irrepressible sense of humor. Ed Shortman and Pat Urban and I one day, while the three of us were working on our dissertations, we were in or around Bob's office, and Bob said, "Let's go watch a Monty Python movie." So we all snuck out. Who had a time card? But we all snuck out feeling very something, and then came back. So these kinds of humorous things cropped up a lot. He readily identified research questions and pursued them with sophisticated theoretical frameworks and state-of-the-art methods, the latter advancing in technical precision and efficiency through successive projects. At Quirigua in the 1970s, for example, this is not in the field, we relied on typewriters and paper forms. What computers? This is an electric typewriter, so we couldn't have that in the field. Chris Kitchen can attest that when we were at Copan in the late 80s, I brought a manual typewriter that just about killed our fingers. But anyway, at Copan, Loa's spatial recording accomplished depictions and understandings not possible at Quirigua. Of course, we couldn't tunnel in the Quirigua Acropolis. Even trenches were very dangerous, as Chris will attest. The unstable cobble fill contrasting dramatically with that tight, stable fill at Copan. Could it be that the ancient regional hierarchy is alive and well? In organizing this talk, it occurred to me more than once, and with a smile each time, that Bob directed the inquiries that successfully located the final resting places of the creative 5th century dynastic founders of both Quirigua and Copan, as described earlier. At the same time, I believe that I've identified the possible resting places for the two 8th century victim and perpetrator of Quirigua's pivotal rebellion against Copan dominance. But we still don't really know for sure. Make no mistake, I'm not belittling my own work, and I love what I do. But in the end, it's Bob Scherer's inquiries that have led to multiple substantive discoveries pertinent to study of ancestors at both Copan and Quirigua, solidly documented in the archaeological and inscriptional records. Let us continue to celebrate and commemorate this newest Mayanist ancestor. Thank you.